Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Know-How is brought to you by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This episode of Know-How is brought to you by SmartThings. SmartThings lets you monitor, control, and automate your home from wherever you are using your smartphone. Right now, SmartThings is offering Know-How listeners 10% off any home security or solution kit, and you get free shipping in the United States when you go to smartthings.com/TWiT and use the offer code TWiT at checkout. And by lynda.com, the online learning platform with over 3,000 on-demand video courses to help you strengthen your business, technology, and creative skills. For a free 10-day trial, visit lynda.com/knowhow. That's lynda.com/knowhow. On a sleepless edition of Know How, it's Camera Basics 101.
Your questions, our answers.
And the start of the Know How 250 FPV quadcopter. Know How. It's the TWiT show where we build, bend, break, and upgrade. I'm Father Robert Ballasaire.
And I'm Brian Burnett.
And for the next 45, 50, 80 minutes.
Give or take. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, we're going to be doing some stuff. Speaking of that stuff, it's all about the projects that we've been playing with for the last couple of weeks.
Yes.
We bring it to you, and hopefully you take it home and geek out on yourself.
That or, you know, we go on the Google Plus network and check out the questions that you guys have or see some of the projects.
Yeah, so we'll be doing a lot of that. By the way, please keep posting all of your videos and pictures of the crashes. They have been glorious.
I'm impressed. I did not know a lot of those frames could snap like that.
Well, like that FPV 250 frame, the little fiberglass one.
Yeah.
That thing can take a beating. Both of us have smashed it in the ground at full speed.
Yeah.
And I see people who have like broken them in half. I'm like, how hard and what did you hit to do that?
Where are you flying these quadcopters? Like in some sort of Hunger Games-esque like arena?
Yeah, Katniss is shooting arrows at them.
Right.
Yeah, but please keep posting those, because in posting those videos and showing people that you're gonna crash, it makes people feel better. I'm not saying that to be snarky. I'm saying people will crash. If you're flying quadcopters, you will crash, and you learn every single time you crash.
Yes, and we all get a few smiles out of it. Yeah.
Yeah. I posted pictures of some of my devastating hits. I mean, I have lost props and motors. I've never snapped a frame. So again,
props.
Wow.
Props.
Speaking of props, we got to give props to a new renewable energy technology. Actually, this is semi-new. We covered this on Know How like a year ago.
This is something, yeah, where you use sunlight to mix with in some sort of fashion to make fuel, renewable
energy.
Yeah.
Back then, it was called SolarJet. It was a project that they were going to run in the Mojave Desert. Quite simply, you use concentrated light. You use a reflector system to get light into one area that increases the heat and the pressure in that area, and then you pump in carbon dioxide and oxygen,
right,
and water vapor. That's it.
Right.
Yeah. And in a multi-step process, what happens is you get a basic chain of combustible molecules, which back in the solar jet you could turn into jet fuel.
Right.
Well, there's a new thing that people are doing. This is a four-step process that has been developed. Alex, if you go ahead and show them, this was, I think it was done in Science Alert magazine. They're calling theirs a blue crude process.
So something like synthetic diesel? Basically?
Synthetic diesel, yeah. And what it does is it generates from a renewable energy source, and this could be solar thermal, wind, hydro, whatever. It just needs power, so you don't have to have a big solar collector. You just need a lot of electricity. That power is used to split water into H2 and O2. It's electrolysis, right? You pass power through water, and it cracks the molecules. The O2 gets vented, and the H2 is passed into a high-pressure reactor, and it's mixed with CO2, where it undergoes a two-step process. Now, the CO2 becomes carbon monoxide, so from carbon dioxide to carbon monoxide, and the H2 then and the released oxygen atom form water. So the byproducts of the first step is water and carbon monoxide. You then add more hydrogen, H2, and it forms a blue crude, which is a liquid energy carrier. Now, that blue crude can be refined into multiple fuels. Diesel, you can actually turn it into straight petrol. But the thing is, you could make that out of air. So you take the things out of air, you put a lot of power into them, and you get something you can burn in a diesel vehicle.
And so does this mixture, can it burn pretty efficiently and cleanly?
Or? Super efficiently, because it doesn't have all that other stuff that comes with refinement. So I mean, when you think about the refinement process, essentially you take crude oil, you boil it, you heat it up. That's why you have these huge stacks. And the gases start to condense at different temperatures as they rise up the tower. And those different temperatures allow you to collect different types of fuel. Everything from heavy oils to gasoline to diesel to at the top you get things like, you know, alcohol.
Wow.
Right. But all that stuff is still in there. You still have this, it's a chemical potpourri. With blue crude, it's just the CO2 and the carbon monoxide and the H2. That's it. Right.
That's pretty cool.
Very cool. It burns more efficiently than regular diesel. It's about 70% efficient. It doesn't have near any of the particulates that you would have in diesel, which are the bad things, right? That's the stuff that the soot that comes out.
Yeah, the contaminants, the black stuff that you see shoot out of the giant diesel tailpipes. Yeah.
Essentially, this leaves you with carbon dioxide and water, I believe, is the byproduct out of the diesel engine burning blue crude.
Cool. I'm hoping that they can like scale this to, you know, wide enough of a range that most of us could take advantage of it.
Yeah, so that's the issue right now. They've been able to make small reactors, small catalyst reactors. So it's not, this is not theoretical. They've actually done it.
Yeah.
They need to be able to scale it up, and they need to be able to scale it up safely, and they need a big enough power source. But here's the thing. Blue crude is a super stable way to store energy. So rather than taking excess energy out of a wind farm or a solar farm and trying to push it onto the grid or put it into lithium-ion batteries, you could use that excess capacity to make blue crude, because that's power that would otherwise be wasted.
Yeah.
And that blue crude can now be burned to make power when you're not getting things from renewable energy.
Right. If the sun's not out or it's dark outside or something like that, yeah.
It's just cool tech. It's cool tech, and I think it's one of these things that we're going to start looking at, because honestly, barring the Tesla event last week, we haven't seen a great advance in battery technology for years.
Yeah, it's been a steady evolution, and I'm sure it's going to get a lot better in the future. But until then, we kind of have to take little baby steps and have them kind of work in junction with each other.
So, actually, cool. Virgil in the chat room has a very good question. He asked you specifically, how does it compare to reclaimed frying oil, which is great. Actually, Patrick Norton's truck runs on fryer oil. It's biodiesel.
Right.
And that has the side effect of making
smelling
his exhaust
delicious.
Smell like French fries.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Awesome.
You know when Patrick's coming into the studio.
You're like, Patrick? No, but it's okay. So here's the thing. That sort of fuel is great because you're using something that would otherwise be thrown away in a vehicle and turned into usable energy. But that's a very finite resource. There's only so many fryers that are going to give you their oil, right?
Definitely.
Whereas blue crude, anytime you have an excess of electricity, you can make diesel fuel.
Yeah, that seems like a much more common event than trying to drive around to all the restaurants around town. Especially if it got really popular.
And when I was living in Berkeley, I actually converted a vehicle to run on fryer oil. And it was so jank. I mean, we had bought, it was a $400 truck. A diesel, like, rusted to heck, but the engine was still working. We had modified the engine, and basically the entire payload area was made of barrels, so you could dump fryer oil, and it would filter it. And there was a little bit of a chemical concoction that we used to make it a bit better for the engine. And you had to mix it with regular diesel, because otherwise it would turn to sludge in the morning.
Jeez.
Very cool, but we, like, the second week, we were working out that it actually took more fuel to drive to the places that might give us their fryer oil.
Right, because you have to go like out of your way to get to those places,
So it was fun, but it was a great experiment to play with that kind of tech, but it wasn't really practical.
A good learning experience.
Yeah,
I looked into it for myself because my mom's car that she was getting rid of was an old Mercedes diesel, but you had to like switch over all the hoses and everything to take it.
All the seals and the pump is probably going to have to be replaced because, you know, trying to run either biodiesel or some sort of biodiesel fryer oil combination really mucks up a lot of those pumps. Yeah, it's not great.
Yeah. But yeah, we're all about alternative energies and the things that they can do.
Speaking of alternative, we've got a user who wants to talk about an alternative way to wire his house. Brian, what is this all about?
So this comes from Luke Kalorsky. He says, hello, KnowHow community. I was wondering if I could use this existing phone line, I think it's Cat5, to convert this phone jack to an Ethernet jack. Any help is appreciated. Looks a little gnarly.
Yeah, flip back and forth between these two pictures. Thank you for sending us those pictures. It really helps us. So this, it looks like relatively new wire. Mm-hmm. So I'm betting this is not Cat3. This looks like Cat5, especially since it's got four pairs. It might even be Cat5e. This might be gig rated, and it's definitely riser rated because it's got the little nylon in there.
Huh.
So you've got some decent cable in here. I'm betting that you would be able to use this for gigabit Ethernet. You could actually look at our episode on premise wiring we did just a couple of weeks back,
mm-hmm.
and it would show you how to terminate this into Keystone jacks so that you can run a solid Ethernet signal through it. There's one little problem, though.
What's the catch?
Okay, here's the catch. Even though the cable could probably be used with a Keystone jack, and
right.
it probably could run a solid gigabit Ethernet signal over it, if it was used for a phone line, they probably went from room to room to room and just, like, punched in serially. You know what I'm saying? They probably didn't run a run from the termination box to every room. They probably just went from room A to room B to room C to room D.
Oh, I see what you're saying, yeah.
Yeah, and if they did that...
Because for a phone line, it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
If you're running... broadband.
It
yeah.
so matters.
Yeah.
you can't tie in serially. And actually, there were people in the comment section who were saying, well, just splice them. You can't just tape them together. That's not how. You could. You get like 10 megabits per second.
That doesn't sound like
gigabit's
the best
going to require all four pairs.
Mm-hmm.
And what you can, there's a couple of options here. Because it's probably Cat5, because it's probably riser rated, the first thing you could do is terminate. So as the wire comes in, right,
mm-hmm.
terminate, and then on the other side put a jack, and then plug this into the jack, and that's a way to splice it. You're going to lose a little bit of signal, but it's not as bad as like using an electrical tape.
Better than trying to splice it wire to wire.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
That's one possibility. The other possibility is if, you know, and again, we need a third picture.
Yeah.
Look at where the wire is coming from. If there's only one wire, then it means that they probably ran it serially. If you see one wire for every room in the house, then you shouldn't have a problem. You should be able to just put a Keystone jack on each side, use a patch panel on the far end, use the Keystones inside your rooms, and you should have a straight Ethernet network.
Cool.
That would be your best bet. There is another option.
Okay.
Kind of expensive,
yeah,
but it's very, very cool. If they are run serially, you could use something like this. These are IntelliJacks. I love these things. Actually, go to the overhead. Essentially, these are managed switches. So you know how we talked about the difference between a dumb switch and a smart switch?
Right.
These are smart switches. So I can do VLANs on this. I can set up multiple networks.
These are
really nice. They can be a little bit pricey. last time I checked, this was like $400.
Oh, okay.
But if you go onto eBay and you look for IntelliJacks, I think this is like the NJ2001 and this is like the NJ1000.
Okay.
You could probably find this. This is the 100 megabit per second version. I've seen them as low as like $25 to $40 each.
Okay, that's not as bad as I thought. Because usually when you're talking about, you know, enterprise hardware or network stuff, it's like, all right, prepare yourself for $1,000 baseline.
Right. But the cool thing about using something like this is, A, it's power over Ethernet. So you could pass in power from the starting point.
That's cool.
And then you could just daisy chain the power. And actually, this one, I think you can daisy chain up to 4 units before it runs out of power.
Okay.
But you could go have one line in, and then you have the next line take one of the ports to go to the other room, and then you have 3 ports inside that wall.
Okay.
Which is not bad. If you want to go the cheap route, buy yourself a bunch of $20 switches, but then you're going to have a bunch of wires coming in and out. I don't know if you want to do
It's not going to be very elegant.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
One last option.
Jeez.
I know.
You're full of them today.
I'm full of options.
Right.
Yeah, how about that? Oh, but one last option is, the difficult part about premise wiring is getting it into the rooms, through the walls.
Right.
If they've already done that, and if it's all serial, and if you want a nice layout, what you can do is and you better do it right the first time.
Oh.
You tie on some fish
and
tape.
And use those.
Yank
too.
It back. Yep. And then you can yank forward the like an actual wiring.
So you're using thing. The old wiring to wire it the
be
way you want
wire,
it to.
Right?
Yeah.
If you're going to do that, make sure you plan it out ahead of time, because there's nothing worse than you're pulling back and then suddenly it becomes a lot easier to pull back and you realize it's just, you've snapped the fish tape and now you have nothing.
Right. That would be heartbreaking.
That's never happened to me.
Definitely not speaking from experience.
Oof. That's why, yeah, I never do premise wiring when I'm tired, because you take shortcuts when you're tired.
and you don't want to do that.
And you just want to throw your hands up. I'm done.
I'm done.
I'm done.
I'm out. Just like flip the table and walk away. Yeah.
That's the worst. All right, we've got another one. Let's go move off of networking for a bit.
Cool.
And someone's got a question about storage.
Some hardware. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it sounds like Jeffrey needs a new drive. I have a Buffalo 500 gigabyte single hard drive NAS box. The Samsung hard drive has finally crashed with the click of death. Yeah, that's a telltale sign.
Yep.
And I want to put the Western Digital, I'm sure that's what that stands for, hard disk inside, and was wanting to know which would be best, the WD Red, the black, or the green. Thanks, Jeff from Australia. So we've talked about the red.
We have.
Talked about the green.
Yes, we have.
I prefer the blacks.
Yes. And that's because each of them has their special talent.
Right.
The reds are fantastic in NASs. That's what they're designed for. They're inexpensive. They run incredibly cool. And they're designed to be run in RAIDs, right?
Mm-hmm.
The greens are supposed to be the economical one. They give you a lot of storage for not that much money. They also run cool, but they tend to be slow.
Right.
They're not real fast. The blacks are the ones that you run for desktop, and they are crazy, crazy fast, just like that fire truck that just went screaming past the studio. And that's why you like them, because you use them in desktops, you use them for video editing. They're not as fast as an SSD, but they give you a lot of oomph.
Yeah, and you can usually get them for a pretty decent size capacity versus like their price. So
now,
I've been able to pick up like 640 gigabyte ones and terabyte ones for, around $100.
Yeah, not bad at all. Actually, I'm going to work Alex now, because we've got a couple of links up. So here's the Red, the Western Digital Red. Right now on Amazon, you can get a 3 terabyte version for about $120, which is, that's not bad. That's not bad for, that per terabyte. That's, but compare that to the green. The green is, for the same 3 terabyte drive, is $100. So yeah, it is less expensive. But the black, if you wanted the 3 terabytes, it's going to be 180. So you're definitely going to be increasing your cost. The black is faster, but it also runs hot.
It runs hot, yeah. It's
now,
more expensive.
When people ask us all the time, well, what's the best drive? You can't tell until you know the application.
And yeah.
Thankfully, Jeff has told us the application. What he wants
is a NAS box.
Is a NAS box. So. But it's a particular type of NAS box. This is the Buffalo 500 gigabyte NAS, so it's network attached, but it's single drive. The Red is not designed for single drive. It does not do well in single drive. The Red
designed
is designed
for
to be
RAID?
A RAID. So RAID 0, RAID 1, RAID 2, RAID 5, RAID 10, whatever it's going to be. That's where it shines. Because one of the things that they've done with the Red is they've removed some of the sub-processing routines that check for, redundant error checking.
Mm-hmm.
Because in a RAID, the RAID's doing that.
Right.
So the drive itself doesn't have to do that.
So what you're saying is it could fail and
you could have
it
issues.
It would be the end.
Yeah. Well, not the end, but like I've actually tested this. I was using a RAID and something funky happened. I had a unexpected power down. Someone kicked the cord.
Mm-hmm.
And what had happened was the index started pointing to the wrong file. So I would have like the name of a file, but it's pointing to a different video.
Weird.
It was the strangest thing. But then I looked it up. I'm like, yeah, that can actually happen with a RAID because it's always assuming that something else is doing the main error check.
The check, yeah.
Right.
Okay.
I would also not put a black in there. A black, A, it's expensive.
Yeah.
You're talking about almost twice as much. And B, it's hot. It runs hot. The black's not designed for RAIDs.
Yeah, the black is something I'd recommend. I mean, that's what I use in my home PC because I'm doing video editing and I'm doing, games.
Yeah.
And I'm reading and writing a lot, to that drive. So I want it to be quick. And it's in a big case with a lot of space, so I'm not too worried about temperature.
Right.
But it sounds like the middle is, the Goldilocks version
that's your
of
Goldilocks.
This.
Yeah, the green. It's not the fastest drive. It runs at 5,400 RPM versus the black 7,200 RPM. But it does run cool, which is what you want in a NAS, because remember, you're sticking this in an enclosure. It's not going to have a whole lot of ventilation.
Yeah.
It will eat itself if it gets too hot. It gives you a lot of space for not that much money. And since you are hooking it up to a NAS, it's probably a backup. It's probably, you're not expecting that much speed out of it. I'm betting the green is your sweet spot, especially like a 3 terabyte green. One caveat though, check with Buffalo, check the support site, and find out what's the largest drive it can support. Not all NASs are updated with the latest drivers or the latest BIOS software, so they don't all support the newest drives.
Right.
So that might actually decide what size you get.
Yeah, definitely check the compatibility on that one.
Yeah.
And then we have another question here.
We do.
From Eddie Foy, and he needs a new soldering station. Time to replace my no longer in business soldering station. Can't get tips anymore. Yeah. I think he means tips for soldering, tips not for tips soldering. From us.
No. No tips for you.
No tips. I can spend $500 for a killer station. I prefer, he could get one for under $200. He doesn't need an SMD/SMT.
Yeah, that's a service mount.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, that's hard work.
He has a couple of suggestions so far from people, and that one is a Hakko. A Weller, which we have down in the basement. I think that's the one Burke prefers.
Yes.
A Metcal and an Edson.
Now, I am not an expert in soldering. In fact, my soldering irons look horrible.
They look a little beat.
Really, really
but
beat.
But that's for demonstration purposes, to show people that you don't necessarily need to have the best to do some of the projects that we've been doing.
I didn't want my projects to be telling people, oh, well, to do this quadcopter project, I need to buy a $4,000 soldering station. No, I mean, mine are $20, $30 ones.
Right.
But I did speak to an expert. The person who I trust is Smitty Halibut.
Smitty has a nice soldering iron.
He does, and he swears by a Metcal. Now, what he says is, it's more expensive, but he would rather have a used Metcal off of eBay than a brand new Weller or Hakko.
Hakko. Okay.
Yeah.
His is like one that he's built himself too.
Right,
it's a little bit of a custom job, or the one he showed me at least. Yeah. I'm sure he has tons of them.
Yeah. Now, we don't have a really good answer for you for this because, you know, we only solder occasionally, but I did want to throw this out in the show because I want to get people into the Google Plus group and give you recommendations. We've actually had some really good recommendations already. In fact, there's one, like a multi-purpose station that has a soldering iron and a heat gun that I'm taking a look at. It's like $80. Probably not the best quality, but it might be exactly what I'm looking for.
Yeah, because the one I've been using for my projects is like the $20 one I got off of Amazon just to see what it was like.
I have a Radio Shack soldering iron from like 1986 that I'm still using. It's like a 20 watt. It's horrible, but it's like, it still works.
I know. I guess it really comes down to how much you're going to be soldering because you'll probably want to do the investment ahead of time. It sounds like Eddie had a decent one and he, you know, used it to the point where he needs to get a new one. So might as well do the nice one up front.
I used to really like Weller.
Years on.
That was my thing. And then when Smitty was here, he kind of said, use a Weller.
Ouch.
And I was like, oh, geez, should I not?
Smitty. I mean, I trust Smitty's opinion. Yeah. I've seen him solder. He's got like,
his hands don't
shake at all. And
so go ahead and jump into the group and tell us what your suggestions are. We'll spread them in a future episode of Know How. Yeah. Well, let's do one last one.
One last one. All right, this one comes from Ben Yankee, and he's got a cellular Ethernet question. Does anyone know of a good GSM to Ethernet modem, something I could hook up to my own router, not a Wi-Fi hotspot that creates its own network? Obviously, I could just buy a hotspot and pick it up with an AP acting as a client and hook that into my router. But that is obviously less than ideal and less reliable.
Ben, good question. And the answer is, actually, there's a lot of options here. Now, some of my favorite, I told the story about this before
pre-show.
The show. I'm not going to tell it now because I think I did break a liar too.
Can't tell that.
This was an old GSM cellular modem.
1994 or something like that?
Heck, yeah. This was really, really old.
It seems like you used it a lot.
Crazy a lot. But this was an old D-Link. This is a DIR450, and it allowed me to plug this in, and I could use this as a cellular to Ethernet router, which was nice. And the nice thing about this, I think this DIR sold for like $27. It was really inexpensive. Going up the chain a little bit, we had something like this. This is a SonicWall TZ27. Oh, stop it, Alex. What are you doing?
You guys need to work together on this.
This is a TZ270. This was an enterprise class router. This was designed for a small to medium business.
Yeah, that looks fancy.
Yeah. Now, the thing is, though, it had multiple broadband options. So it had a WAN, and I could set several of these for, like, using DSL or cable modems or whatever. Then it also had this port in the side so I could put in that card.
Sneaky.
So that if I lost all my wired connections, it would switch over to the wireless.
Oh, okay.
Which was kind of nice.
This is like actually, your failsafe.
This was my failsafe. Now, this is old, though. I think this was released in 1996. Ooh. So it's
probably not something you can get your hands on right now.
No, they don't sell these anymore. But what they do sell, they sell things like this. This is a Netgear. This is a mobile 3G Plus. Now, like the TZ170, it's designed to use a broadband option. In this case, it's DSL. But it also has this USB port here, and into that USB port, I could plug a 3G, 4G dongle. It will do the backup. Now, if I didn't have a DSL plugged in there, this actually just acts like a 3G, 4G router.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, these are all decent options, and they will run you anywhere from about $27 all the way up to, I think the most expensive would probably still be the TZ in the $300, $400 range. But for my money, there is no better buy than what's called a Cradle Point. They specialize in this. This is what they make. And hey, Alex, let's go ahead and show them what it does.
I'm Father Robert Ballester, the digital Jesuit, here at CES 2014, Showstoppers for Twit TV. I'm standing with Ken Hosak, the Vice President of Business Development for Cradle Point. Ken, thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it, Robert.
Now, you've got a hatchet. But there's a good reason why you have a hatchet, and it doesn't have to do with anything of violence against people. It's to show you why redundant external paths are important. In other words, multiple WANs. If you run a small business, a home business, or even a small branch, but with a large business, you need to have multiple paths to the outside. If your business is on the internet and you get disconnected, what are you? You're dead. Ken, tell me what Cradle Point does to guarantee that we always stay connected.
We're very good at 4G LTE, and so we have network equipment that uses the wireless internet from Verizon, AT&T as a failover for wired internet like cable and DSL or T1 lines. And so if it goes out, we're able to cut over. And so many businesses use cloud-based apps. Small businesses use Google apps. Large businesses use their own apps. We keep it going. You need that network access. It's your Achilles heel.
There are a lot of products that provide multiple WAN functionality, but one of the things I've noticed is they're not always seamless in how they switch over. In fact, one of the products that I bench tested last year took a full 3 minutes before I started getting a regular flow of traffic. You can't have that. I mean, especially if your business is online, you cannot lose connectivity. Now, could you show me in, I don't know, say a creative way, what it looks like when you lose your connection?
Well, typically the first thing you see is a wired internet connection that breaks.
Just like that, yes.
And then the second thing that happens if you don't have a Cradle Point solution is you have no internet access. If you have Cradle Point, I just flipped over, in this case, to Verizon 4G LTE, didn't even notice it, I lost the internet.
Now, if they want to find out more about Cradle Point, about your solutions, about what you could maybe do for them, where should they go?
Google Ken the X, or you can go to cradlepoint.com, and we'd be happy to talk about it.
Ken, thank you very much for talking to us. Thank you for showing off your tech, and thank you for CES 2014.
Thank you.
Surprisingly, there weren't a lot of people crowded around the Cradle Point booth.
I was going to say, was your review compromised at all because of the hatchet?
I was like, so what you going to do with that, Ken?
Yeah, this is a great product, a really good product.
But actually, it was quite a good demonstration because he would cut the line and
there was no interruption.
Nothing.
That's pretty cool.
It switched over immediately. That's actually really hard to do.
Yeah, that's neat. And as you had mentioned, we were going to talk about this. People in the chat room, everyone was saying, like, Cradle Point.
Cradle Point if you want to do wireless cellular solutions, there's no one better than Cradle Point. They really do it better than everybody else. And the nice thing about those solutions is they package multiple options in there. So you can use three or four different hardline broadband options. You can use USB. You could use a hardwired card inside the Cradle Point itself. So, you know, basically, any way you want to connect, you can connect. If you use one of these buses in the Bay Area that has Wi-Fi access, more likely than not, it's probably a Cradle Point router providing that access.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty smart, too.
It is smart. Speaking of things that are smart, you know what I want? I want a smart house. Now, at CES this year, the smart house, the automated house, the connected house was all the rage. You've seen it, right, Brian? I mean, you want to have your doodads, your electronics connected. You want
I
want to
walk into
connected.
My house, have the lights turn on, play some classical music, and then start working on my Android.
That was the promise.
I watched Ex Machina recently.
You gotta stop watching those movies. Yeah, that was the promise of the smart house way back when, and we kind of got there.
Yeah.
The problem that we've had over the last decade is there's been a lot of different competing solutions, right?
Yeah.
Vendor X wants you to buy everything from them. Vendor Y wants you to buy everything from them. But what happens when some of the items you want are from Vendor X and some are for Vendor Y?
And you want to tie them together.
There just wasn't a really good way to do that. Well, that's what SmartThings did. Now, they were voted the best buy, best smart house alternative or option at CES 2015.
And by CNET, right?
Yeah, by CNET. And it's really easy to see why. Because what they allowed you to do was to tie together not only the options that they had, the tools that they had, the sensors that they had, but the sensors, the tools, the items, the automation gizmos from pretty much every major manufacturer out there.
I mean, now, this is the brain right
here. That's the brain. That's the hub. So this is the thing that lies connected to your house, connected to your broadband option, and it allows you to go in with your smartphone, your tablet, basically your Android, your iOS device, and control everything that's connected to it. Now, it's not just things like the motion sensor, or they've got a smart power outlet so you can control power. It's not just moisture sensor so that you can find out whether or not there's water in your basement, or a temperature and humidity sensor. It also includes things like this.
The little key fob.
That's the thing I like. That makes it so that my house knows when I come home. And because it can run on I call it IFTY, I love IFTY.
IFTY, yeah.
Yeah, it allows you to set things like when I'm home, turn the lights on, open the doors, turn my music on to the station that I like, maybe take a picture so that I can verify later on that I was entering by myself.
Yeah.
These are the kind of things that you can do when you have a true smart home. Yeah.
Now, this is the open close
I like
one too.
Yeah, you have to use that for your security.
Definitely.
Now, it's not just the sensors and the gizmos and the gadgets from SmartThings. You could use it with your Nest thermometer or thermostat. You could use it with your drop cams. You could use it with your Sonos Wi-Fi audio system. And that's the idea behind SmartThings, which is take everything you have
and make it work together.
And make it work together.
Cool.
Now, this is what we want you to do. We want you to try out what CNET called the best home automation system of CES 2015. And that means going over to SmartThings, trying out their system. See if maybe you want to be able to control your house from your Android, from your iOS device. You can use it from home automation. You can use it for security. You can use it for energy saving. You can use it for water detection. The only important thing is that you do use it. SmartThings has no required monthly fee, and kits start at just $189. SmartThings is an affordable way to create your smart home. And just for our Twit audience, SmartThings is offering you a chance to save even more. You can get 10% off any home security or solution kit, and you get free shipping in the United States when you go to smartthings.com/twit and use the offer code TWIT. That's smartthings.com/twit and use the offer code TWIT. SmartThings, a smart home for you right now.
Today. Future is now.
And the future.
Yesterday.
And we thank SmartThings for their support of know-how. Now, Brian, let's get into some camera knowledge.
Yes. Because when we started talking about this geeking out that we occasionally do, you were very much more from the old school side of photography, whereas I didn't have my first DSLR, or well, digital single lens camera until I started working here. And one of the first shows I started working on was This Week in Photography, which got me in love with it. So tell me, what were the...
Young whippersnapper. Here, hold on to these for a second. Here's some toys for you to play
toys?
With.
Toys?
Yeah.
These kind of look like surgical equipment.
They really do, right? Like, no, that actually harkens back to a time that we're going to be talking a little bit about. Believe it or not, that was the equivalent of a remote shutter.
What?
Yeah. So, right? This is the kind of technology that's going to baffle you.
Hmm.
So what it would do is you had a shutter button, right?
You
press it. Well, the shutter buttons on old cameras had a little mounting hole you could screw this into, and so you could stand off from the camera and press it and trigger the shutter. This was high tech back then, man. Don't be laughing.
When you said that, the first thing that came into my mind was like Wile E. Coyote with like the you know, the TNT. He like lays down all the cable and then.
Oh, and actually, I was trying to find. I threw out a bunch of stuff, and I'm really sad that I did. But
well, why would you? When was the last time you even used it?
I know. Well, that's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
There was a little. It used the same mounting hole, but it looked like just a little piece of metal, and there was a switch that you would wind. and it was a clock, and that was how you would time the camera to take a picture 10 seconds from now. It would go and when it hit zero, it would like shoot out a little rod.
So was this during the time when people wouldn't smile in their photos either?
You know, that was a daguerreotype. No. Okay. I knew this was a mistake to do this with you. All right, so we do want to talk about some basic camera knowledge, because believe it or not, knowing where we came from in terms of cameras and film actually brings us really well into the new era of digital photography and digital videography. Specifically, I want to talk about light.
Yeah.
Now, in the old days, there were three ways that we could harness light to make an image.
Mm-hmm.
Right. There was the film that we would use, because the film could have different levels of sensitivity to light.
Right.
I used to call it the ASA. It was starting, I believe, after me. They called it the ISO, ISO standard, and before that, it was called the DIN. There was a rating system that would determine how quickly the emulsion on the film would react to light. You're laughing at me.
It's fascinating. It just seems like a lot of work.
Photoshop kind of killed all this, but it was good.
Continue. Don't ignore me.
So there's the film,
mm-hmm.
and then there's actually allowing the light to get to the film. And
right.
there were two mechanisms inside of a camera that allowed you to control that. One was called the aperture.
And the other was the shutter?
The shutter, right. So the aperture was just how wide the hole was that allowed light to come through it. And the shutter was the mechanism that actually, in the old, the reason why it's called a DSLR is because there used to be the SLR, the single lens reflex.
Right.
It was actually a mirror that, in its normal position, the light reflected from the lens up into the mirror, up into another mirror, into your eye.
So you could see it.
And then when you push the button, you would actually lose sight of it for a second because the mirror would flip, because the light would stop going into the eyepiece and go back into the film.
Right. You can actually see it in this, but
right.
I don't know if we'll have too good of a shot of it.
Oh, you know how we could get that? We could use this.
Oh, this second camera
Had back here? Oh, look at that. Oh, how about that? Huh?
It's a little dark, Padre.
I can fix that. There we go. All right, see?
Yeah, so inside here you can see that little reflective piece. That's the mirror so that you can see into the eyepiece back here, right?
Right, right. And that's the regular underneath. Position. But when you, that's why there's that mechanical noise. When you push that button, it will flip that mirror and the light stops going from the into the eyepiece and it goes down into the film. Or in this case, it goes to the sensor.
I don't think it's going to trigger without the lens. I don't think so.
Yours is too. My old mechanicals would, but the new ones, they know.
They're
well
too
enough.
Smart. The machines.
Too dang smart. Too dang smart. Okay, so those are the three different ways to get light into a camera and to manipulate it, right?
Right.
Now, you needed a certain amount of light in order to properly form an image. Too much light, and you got a blown out picture.
Right.
Too little light, and it was all black. In fact, I've got some old, these are called negatives, Brian.
What?
Yeah. So this is what photography and videography used to look like.
Why are they in this plastic stuff?
This is my graduation. So this was actually a piece of cellophane. It was plastic that had a light-sensitive emulsion on it based on silver. Right. So these are all black and white photographs. And what would happen is any place that the light hit, when you developed it, it would remove those pieces.
But if
it didn't hit, it would be dark. Hence the negative. Yeah. That's really. Let me change that a little bit. Ooh, there we go.
Yeah.
So now you can see a little better.
Here.
Yeah. So that's why we would, exactly. That's why we used to call them negatives. Let me change the manual focus here so I can get a better focus on it.
Where are the cameramen
there
now?
There we go. We took the control from Alex.
It's like looking at ghosts.
And that's what we did. He took it back. That's how we played with photography, right?
I feel like Alex is just messing with us today.
He's cranky.
Finally, he's got the power over us.
Now, let's go ahead and talk about ISO. ISO. Okay. That's the film sensitivity that we've been talking about.
Right.
You used to be able to buy film. Again, film, not digital. Buy film that had different levels of sensitivity. Right. Typically, we would have like 100, 200, 400, 800, 1600. The higher you went, mm-hmm. the more sensitive it was to light.
And this all depended on what you wanted to shoot, right?
Correct, right. If you were shooting if you had a lot of light, you would actually shoot the lowest speed film that you could.
Right.
Because while a faster speed film would be able to shoot in like lower light conditions, as you get into the faster films, what would happen is those little silver particles would tend to clump together. and you would get what was called grain. Have you ever seen? In fact, Alex, yep. I think we've got, yeah. This is what a grainy picture looks like, and that's because all those little pieces clump together, and rather than getting a nice, smooth transition between the pixels, what we would call them now, back then it was the silver particles, you would get this grainy image, right?
Right. I've always heard it described as noise when you have the ISO really high and you're taking pictures in the dark.
Right. And we'll actually talk about that because that's how we transitioned to the digital age. Mm-hmm. So the rule with the ISO was use the lowest possible that you could get away with, but if you were shooting in low light, you would use faster and faster films.
Faster films, slower shutter speed.
Faster speed. We'll talk about this.
Okay,
you're
getting
ahead
of myself.
This is just ISO. Now remember, so slower films look good, have a lot of detail, have a lot of contrast,
right.
But they're not so light sensitive. Faster films are more light sensitive, but you start losing details, you start getting grain, and you start losing contrast.
Okay.
All right. So we go from that. That's ISO. That's just the film. To let's start talking about the mechanics. The first part was aperture. Now aperture is actually we could show you an aperture. Let's do this little thing here, Brian. Hold on.
I'll try and hold it still here.
Hold still me. Zoom in.
Enhance.
Wait.
Zoom in.
There we go.
There you go.
Okay, so the aperture is actually here. Let me hold that, and then you can trigger the.
Here, I'll follow you.
It's actually a mechanical. Yeah, can you focus in on this a little bit? There we go.
Focus.
It's a mechanical device inside the lens or inside the camera that actually allows you to vary the amount of light that makes it through the lens.
Right? So that's a lot of light, that's not very
This
much
is
light
very light. Little light, and that's a whole lot of light. In fact, let's see if I can get the rating on this. This is a... Oh, that's right. This is Russian, isn't it?
It is Russian. This is like made from tank steel.
Oh, this is a 2 to a 16 f-stop.
Yeah,
and that tells you the rating, right?
Two.
So if we rate the opening in f-stops, we start at 1.4, then 2, 2.8, 4, 5.6, 8, 11, 16, 22, and 32. Every time we go up one, we are actually doubling or having the amount of light that makes it through. So f1.4 is that, f32 is that. Right? So we keep decreasing the amount of light that makes it through. Now, we're not just doing that for fun. Changing the f-stop actually changes.
There we go.
It changes the quality of the photo because it changes what's called the depth of field. When I use an f1.4, it allows a lot of light through, but it means that only the thing that is in the focus plane will be in focus. Everything else will be out of focus.
So that's good for like portraits, probably.
Right. See, this is using a very small aperture. Low aperture, so that only the thing that's in focus is in focus. But if you scroll through these, Alex, I think there's going to be a couple that have a larger depth of field. Right. And so if you use like F16, you're going to have things that are in focus in the foreground and in the background in addition to the actual image. We use this a lot. Whenever we do reviews for Before You Buy, both of us like playing with finite focus.
Yeah, I like to do that because it also helps you pull the viewer's view to the thing that you're talking about on a product. Right. Yeah.
Bleep Blurper saying that he used to have a lens that was F1. Yeah.
1.0.
So that's so much light that allows in. It's great for low light photography, but those lenses were crazy expensive.
Yeah.
Ridiculously expensive.
Yeah, because I think I had a 50 millimeter lens. That it would go down to, I want to say 2 or 1.8 or something.
Yeah,
and that one was still like, you know, a couple hundred dollars.
Right.
And then the other Canon lenses that you want, if you wanted the nicer ones with the L glass, I think is what they're called, with the little red band around the end, they start to get into like the $1,000 range.
So, yeah, exactly. Yeah, and you know, these can get kind of pricey.
But
it was expensive habit back then.
The glass never changes. The bodies always get better, but the glass...
Well, that's what people say. You buy the lenses, and then the bodies are kind of... You just
transition them as you go.
Which is why it used to be you were either a Nikon guy or a Canon guy, because you invested so much money in your lenses. You're not going to switch.
you're stuck at that point.
I'll change off the body, but the lenses, those are mine forever.
Okay.
Now, let's move on to the last thing. So aperture allows light, a lot of light or a very small amount of light to come through. And if you're allowing a lot of light, it has no depth of field.
Right.
If you allow very little light, it has a huge depth of field.
Right.
The last part was shutter. Now, we talk about shutter. It's the thing that you could hear in your camera.
The click, yeah.
The click. That's the moment at which it would allow light through. Right. Now, in the old film cameras, it would allow light through onto the emulsion. In the DSLRs, it allows light onto the sensor.
Right, makes sense. Yeah.
Now, yours is still using a mechanical solution. You still have a lens that pops up and down. A lot of cameras, like the non-DSLRs.
The mirrorless ones?
The mirrorless ones are actually all using electronic shutter. So light is always hitting the sensor, but it only takes a picture at when you push the shutter.
Right.
And a lot of people don't like that because this is the more purest way to do it. And it actually does look better when you're using a DSLR.
I'm trying to take a photo here. I'm sure you'll hear it over the mic once I turn on the camera.
Yeah, you have to push the button.
There you go. I want the flash.
So, there it is. Now, so the shutter was a mechanism that allowed you to allow light in just for a measured amount of time. Mm-hmm. And typically that time was measured in a fraction of a second.
Right.
So one was 1 second. But then you would have 1/60th. That's 1/60th of a second. 1/4th is a quarter of a second.
Right.
1/2000th is a 1/2000th of a second. The faster it goes, so the smaller that ratio means it's allowing less light in.
Right.
Now, the reason why you would want that is the less light you allow in, the faster it could take a picture.
The more,
motion.
Right, because if anything's moving while you take a photo, you'll get that blur effect.
Right, so 1/60th is about, that's the transition space. So 1/60th, you're going to get a little bit of blur. If you have fast motion, you really want 1/125th. Anything below 1/160th, that's like long exposure.
That's when
you
start to need like a tripod and stuff, right?
Yeah, yeah. I would never not use a tripod if I'm going to be shooting 1/60 or below.
Right.
So those were the different ways that we could control light. We could control it with the film, we could control it with the aperture, or we could control it with the shutter.
Okay.
So, well, is that time where you ask, why do we care?
Yeah,
who cares? We don't use this anymore. In fact, here's another relic from my time. This was a bulk film winder.
What?
I know you don't know what this is because you don't use film.
Dramatic
but
pause?
But if you open this up, and actually
there's still
film in there. This is a roll of black and white that I had back from 1998.
Ooh.
So it's been a while. Okay. It's been a while. Okay. What you would do is you would put your film canister in there, and then you could wind it full of film. And the little counter would tell you how many feet you had wound onto the spool. and it was actually set up. I know. It looks weird. It looks... But this, you could save so much money this way. And it also meant I could do custom wines.
Right. I was just trying to equate that to what it is now. It's like having a bigger SD card that you just keep putting your stuff on, right?
But you got to remember, so one of the things that I would do is I would not wind as many shots because I wanted to be able to change the speed of my film.
Mm.
It wasn't as easy as changing a button back then because I had to take the film out of the camera. And of course, that would destroy it. So you would have to wind it, which basically would waste a lot of film. So rather than rolling spools that had 24 or 32 shots, I would roll spools that had 10 shots.
Okay.
And then that would allow me to, flip speeds when I needed to.
Man, I'm glad I didn't have to deal with that. I definitely have my appreciation for film. I never did a dark room stuff.
You're laughing on the inside.
Well, no, because
yeah, you are.
What ends up happening is, I think, actually the first digital camera I used was Alex's in high school, and I just took pictures of everything. Like, didn't know what I was doing, I was just taking pictures.
Right.
And I feel like it took me a lot longer to learn how to set up a shot. Yeah, and then after I did the photo show with Leo, and he was talking about all the, like...
You get an appreciation for it.
You get an appreciation, and it helped. You can take a ton of pictures with your SD card, but... If you want to be able to set up a shot the way you want it and get it right without having to do a bunch
your
of shot test
before
shots.
The tendency right now is to shoot a bunch of shots.
Right.
And then you take the ones that are not crap.
Right.
The way that my generation did it was because this was so cumbersome. This was a pain in the butt. You wouldn't take it unless you knew it was a shot you wanted.
Right. Because you were wasting film.
You're wasting money. Remember, because I used to manually develop all my stuff. And that took...
With the chemicals
now
and everything?
It's 20 seconds for me downloading it and getting into Photoshop.
Yeah.
It was a couple of hours when I wanted to do a dark room session.
Yeah.
But so let's get past that.
My appreciation.
And talk about this. So this is actually a modern camera. This is a Panasonic AG-HMC-150. It's what I've been using in my studio for like the past 6 years or so.
You shoot all your reviews and
all my reviews are shot with the Pani. Now, believe it or not, even though this is a modern camera and it's completely electric, it has all the analogs to those three things that we talked about.
The shutter, the aperture.
And the ISO, the film ISO sensitivity, right? Which is weird because this doesn't have any film in it, right?
Right.
Except it does. This is called the gain control. So I can flip a switch here. Notice how it ups my gain or downs my gain, right? Mm. Now, the cool thing is, so this is what the regular shot would look like. If I increase my gain, I can increase the amount of information that makes it to the lens. But as you notice, it's
brighter.
Yeah, it's making the shot look not so great. It's actually adding grain to my shot. I lose
hard
detail. I lose contrast. I'm going
to
lose a little bit of the definition. And it just doesn't look as good. And it's a very good analog to the film ISO. Exactly. So, you know, I always try to shoot with 0 decibels of gain because gain is bad. But if it's a low light situation,
then you gotta do it.
I gotta do it. The other thing I can do is I can control my aperture. If you go back to the screen, Alex, notice that little number, F2.4, that's actually my stop.
Right.
So it actually goes all the way down to F1. So this is completely open. There's nothing in the way of the light coming into the sensor at all. But then I can increase that. F1.7, 2.0, 2.4, 2.8. And you'll notice every time I go up a stop, it's actually having the amount of light that comes into the lens. And I can, on this one, I can go all the way up to
11.
F16.
Which
is closed. Which is really not useful.
Thanks, F16.
But yeah, so F11 is the last useful stop on this particular camera.
Okay.
Let's go back to...
So that's something you use if you're out in broad daylight?
In broad daylight. But the nice thing about this, and actually, let me see if I can do it on this and take this camera off the stand. Let me show you that depth of field thing that I was talking about that both of us like to do. So I've got this keyboard. Go ahead and show the keyboard. I'm going to set this for very fine depth of field. So at open... Basically, the only thing that's going to be in focus is the thing that I'm focusing on. Now, I got a toy with this because I don't want it to be overblown. So I'm going to put on a neutral density shutter. And now you'll notice, hold on, let me get this. See how I can transition between what's in focus? So that's the far side of the keyboard, and now let's go to the near side. Far side, near side.
Yeah.
This is a shot that both of us like to use a lot.
Definitely.
Yeah, right? And that's very finite depth of field. Now let me swap it. Let me go back open. Let's open this up as much as possible. I'll turn on this light so I can get even more light onto there. So now I'm at F11. Now, no matter what I'm focusing on, everything's in focus.
Yeah.
That's like a very, very deep depth of field. It's useful, but you know, if you're trying to be kind of artistic, a lot of people don't use extreme depth of field.
Yeah, because that's like what you see in movies more often.
Right, everything's in focus. Yeah, which, you know, a lot of people don't like the look of.
Right.
Now, the last bit is the shutter, and which is strange, again, because this doesn't have a shutter. There is no mechanical shutter in there, otherwise you'd be hearing it click, 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 click,
right.
click. But what it does have is it has the electrical version of a shutter. So if you go back to my shot, Alex... I'm focusing a lot on you, which is
There's
weird.
Not a lot else in the area.
I can press this button, and now it's imitating a shutter. So this is one-third. Actually, let's take it even down further. Remember what I said about motion blur? Exactly. See how it's blurring all your motion? Everything, all the stuff is coming together because I'm shooting so slowly. Now, that allows me to get a lot of light, so I can get way more light than I normally would, but it also means that if something's moving, I'm gonna blur it out. However, I could jack this all the way up. I can go to like I think I can go with the 1/2000th here to see if I'm gonna have to light you up.
Oh God, no.
Actually, there's not enough light to go to 1/2000 here. I can probably go to
blinding me with that
1/500th or so. Let's go up on the gain. There we go. And
yeah,
now,
you can't like see anything in the background.
Right, but now go move your hands quickly, and nothing's gonna blur because it is shooting so quickly. In fact, see, we've got Mr. Leo Laporte here, and I don't know what's happening right now.
He's going so fast, it's hard to capture it on the camera.
Actually, let me activate the shutter mode here because we could blur him. He's moving so quickly.
Look out for the zoom in.
But okay, so now you see I've got all of those things in my brand new electrical air tank.
Right, without all those physical mechanical systems. That's cool.
But the important thing here is there's an interrelation here, because I do need a certain amount of light to hit the sensor in order to get a fully formed picture, right?
Right.
So I can toy with all three of those to get the right amount. If I want a very finite depth of field, because I want to do that cool focus here, focus there trick, it means that I need to use, I have to have my aperture all the way open, which means I either have to close down my shutter a little bit, or it means that I have to use some sort of density filter so that I can tap down the amount of light that makes
it in. Which you have one, right?
Right.
Is there one on there?
It's built on, right? Okay. Or I want to go the other way around. If I want to have a huge depth of field, it means I got to throw a whole lot more light on there, or I got to use a slower shutter, or I have to raise the gain.
Right, right.
So these are all things that you can do to toy with your images.
And it all depends on what you're shooting. Like if you're shooting something stationary and you want to get that depth of field, you have the lower, like an F2, right?
Right.
Like something like that.
Right.
But when I'm shooting sports or like something that's moving very quickly, I want the... Is there something happening behind me, Padre?
No.
Keep going. Is there a segue?
No, yeah, you're right. Sports, you're going to want a high shutter speed.
Right. So
Now we're going to be doing a couple more series on this. I know this was a lot of information, but this was all the basics. So these three basics, we're going to combine in different situations. We're going to take it outdoors. We're going to take it downstairs. We're going to do indoor shots, outdoor shots, low light shots, studio light shots.
You may have told me that a couple days ago to film something of that. And
Who knows?
Didn't really get to it for this show.
But we're going to show you, because the best way for you to figure out what your equipment is capable of doing is to actually go do it.
Yeah, definitely.
Speaking of knowing what your equipment is capable of doing, I'm glad that we've got the next sponsor of this episode of Know How, because they'll show you exactly what your equipment is capable of doing. Now, here at Know How, we're all about knowledge.
Absolutely.
And we're all about the knowledge hole.
You know, fill in those gaps.
You got to fill in the gaps, because we can only give you so much. Now, if you want to know more about photography, about videography, you got to go someplace online that can give you that information, that can fill in the gaps in your knowledge hole, which is why you've got lynda.com.
Yes.
Now, lynda.com is the one-stop shop, the repository of knowledge on the internet. And right now, we want you to go there because they've got a series of videos on basic photography and basic videography. In fact, Alex is going to show you some of the material that they can give you. If you want to know how to set up your camera, if you want to know how to frame your shot, if you want to know how to light what you're doing, that's what lynda.com is for.
And learn how to use a DSLR or a video camera or a GoPro, like anything, any equipment that you may be interested in, you can find on Lynda.
Right. And it's not just photography. Lynda.com is for problem solvers, for the curious, for people who want to make things happen. Maybe you want to take better photos. Maybe you do want to redesign your website or master Excel. Or maybe sharpen your Photoshop skills because you don't want to be like me in a dark room for 8 hours to get one single frame. Lynda.com has everything that you need to feed your curious mind. Now, some of the new Lynda courses that I recommend are Getting Started with Video Production and Editing, Final Cut Pro 10.2 Essential Training for Developing Android Apps, and Up and Running with Lightroom 6 and Lightroom CC. There also are new installments of Code Clinic covering C, R, Swift, and JavaScript. With a lynda.com membership, you can watch and learn from top experts who are passionate about learning, stream thousands of video courses on demand, and learn on your own schedule. You can learn at your own pace. Courses are structured so that you can watch them from start to finish or consume them in bite-sized pieces. You can browse each course transcript. This is the part that I really like. Rather than having to fast forward through a bunch of video, you can search for a particular question that you have, and lynda.com will take you directly to the video and the part of the video that makes sense. You can take notes as you go, and you can refer to them later, or you could download those tutorials and watch them on the go, including on your Android or your iOS device. You could create and save playlists of courses that you like, so you could send them to your friends and say, hey, you know what? I think you'd benefit from a video production course. Now, here's what we want you to do. We want you to learn something. Your lynda.com membership gives you unlimited access to training on hundreds of topics, all for one flat rate. Whether you're looking to become an expert, you're passionate about a hobby, or you just want to learn something new, I want you to visit lynda.com/knowhow and sign up for your free 10-day trial. That's lynda.com, lynda.com/knowhow. And we thank Lynda for their support of Know How. Brian, magically all this quadcopter stuff has appeared on our table, which is kind of strange. Yeah.
Where did that come from?
Now, we have been playing a lot with this. This is the Hobby King FPV 250. This
not just us, though.
Everybody.
A lot of people.
A lot of,
a lot of broken parts.
A lot of broken parts. In fact, a lot of people have ordered these to the point where Hobby King doesn't really have them anymore.
Oh.
They kind of out of stocked them. And actually, this whole project is brought to us by a single question from Eric Berger, who, what do you say, Brian?
He asks about Twit 122 and 250 FPV. Mm-hmm. Okay. He says, hi guys, I've been wanting to build a 250 FPV quad. Who doesn't? And now that spring is arriving, I'd really like to do this and take advantage of the better weather. The FPV 250 kit you recommended looks great, but when it's been back order on Hobby King forever. Can you recommend another kit from another vendor? Also, do you make specific hardware recommendations for a few items you still have to buy slash add, like controllers and transmit devices and receivers?
Yes, and the answer is yes, yes, and no. We're and not going to suggest another kit because... Uh-huh. We're past the kit stage. We don't need... The reason why we asked you to buy the FPV 250 was because everything was in the box except for the controller and the transmitter.
Right.
And it didn't require any soldering. But I think the know-it-alls are past that point.
Okay.
Yeah. So what we want to do is we want to start a project where we're going to be building not the Hobby King 250, but this is the Know-How 250.
Our own brand of 250.
This is our own brand of 250. Okay. Hobby King was not bad. It's a good trainer.
Yeah.
But we want to give you something with a bit more oomph, with a bit more capability. And believe it or not, it's going to be about the same price or even cheaper than the Hobby King 250.
And you get to build it yourself.
You get to build it yourself.
It's all fun.
Now, there's a couple of parts here. We're going to put this part list on the website, so you don't have to write it down now. But you're going to start.
Check the show notes.
You can check the show notes. You're going to start with the same frame. This is that FPV 250 frame with extension. Mm-hmm. I am going to recommend a lot of these parts from Ready to Fly Quads. I actually had a conversation with Paul Baxter. Mm-hmm. And remember, we get no... There's no advertising from Ready to Fly Quads. They give us nothing. I just really like what they do. Sometimes some people have complained that it takes a while to get the orders. I understand that, but
it's
support
a small operation, right?
It's a small operation.
Yeah.
It's the same FPV 250 kit. In fact, judging from what we've seen on our Google Plus group, you may want to get a couple of these because people are snapping them.
Yeah, I guess depending on your flying characteristics. Have you tried flying a Saima? And if you've destroyed that, then you might need a couple extra frames if you're doing this project.
What I like about the kit that comes on Ready to Fly Quads is that it actually includes this, if you go to the overhead. This is the long frame. So this bolts on to the standard fiberglass 250.
Right.
And it gives me the ability to put things like FPV cameras and all the transmitters that I'm going to need. It gives me more real estate, and I'm going to have so much more power in this build that I really don't have to worry about adding a little bit of extra weight. So that's going to be my frame. My motors are these. These are 2208, also from Ready to Fly Quads. So if you go over to that link, what I like about these is they provide a crazy amount of thrust. So with the same props that they used on the FPV 250 from Hobby King, that would generate maybe 500 grams of thrust for all four motors.
Right.
This can generate about 700 grams of thrust per motor.
Yes.
So.
Power.
Just so you know, there's a whole lot of power here.
Well, and you're adding extra stuff, extra weight, cameras, transmitters, stuff like
that.
Right. So you're going to need the power.
And as far as the electronic speed controllers, if you go to that link again, I would again recommend these. These are my favorite. These are the Ready to Fly Quads F30 Fire, the Red Series. They're $10 a pop. They're not that expensive. Now, you could go ahead and get yourself like the 12 amp. You could probably get away with 12 amp, but one of the things I want to do in this design is I want to make these parts reusable.
So if you're going to be upgrading down the road, you want to have probably something better.
Exactly. And they're the same price, so you might as well get the 30. And you've got so much spare power on this craft. The tiny bit of extra weight that these are going to add over a 12-amp controller.
Marginal.
It's marginal. Yeah. Go and get yourself the more capable ones.
Cool.
Now, we also need a flight controller. We have been using the KK 2.1.5 because it's nice and easy. I would now suggest you go to something a bit more advanced. This, right here, this is the Flip. That's the Flip 1.5. Now, one of the things that the Flip can do, this can do hybrid self-level. Which means if you want to flip your quad without having to go to full manual, this is a really good way to do it.
That looks really cool, too.
Yeah, it's a nice one.
Is there a little breakout board here?
There's a little breakout board there. So I've added altitude control, and I've also added this, which allows me to hook it up to a Bluetooth module so I can actually set the settings from my phone.
That's awesome.
Which is very cool. We're going to show you how to do that. So, yeah, go a little more advanced controller than the 2.15.
For $15, huh?
Yeah.
Nice.
You're also going to need a distribution board. Actually, you could see it inside here. A power distribution board is just a little piece of copper. Oh, there we go.
Yeah, I knew I had it on here. There. I almost
broke it. It's a tiny piece of copper that has some soldering points so that you can distribute power to everything in your craft that needs power.
Right.
And along with that, you're going to need a male XT60. You're going to need 12-gauge wire. And you're going to also need a bunch of 5x3 Gemflan nylon props and bullets. Now, I would suggest the 3.5mm bullets just because, again, we want this to be reusable. I could probably get away with the 2mm, but if I ever want to reuse these parts for a bigger craft, I want the bullets to match.
Very cool.
Now, all of that's going to be on the website. But here's the cool thing. The Hobby King would run you about $103.
Okay.
But then it was always out of stock, so you had to buy it international, which added about $16 of shipping. And it didn't include a flight controller, so at minimum that would be about $22. So the Hobby King kit was $140, give or take. This kit shipped because Ready to Fly Quads has a flat rate shipping of $4.50. is about $153.
Not bad.
So 140 versus 153, this is a far more capable craft. And actually, if you went ahead and downgraded these to like the 1806 motors and downgraded the ESCs to 12-amp 4-in-1s,
if you weren't interested in upgrading later.
Right. This would be about $18 cheaper than the Hobby King.
That's cool. Nice. Now,
the difference, though, is that this is going to require soldering, and this is not a complete kit. You do need to follow our instructions because you're not going to have everything in one nice, neat box.
Okay.
Now, I spoke with Paul Baxter, and he did say that he has all of these parts that I put on the list available now.
Cool.
So like we did with the Alien X build, we're going to give you a couple of weeks before we start building this because we want people who want to get a very nice, agile Acro 250 to have time to order the parts so they'll be ready for the build. Now, the cool thing about this is we are doing FPV. So FPV will go in here. We are going to show you racing. We're going to show you acro.
I want to play with it now.
We're going to be building GPS into this baby so that you can do things like positioning hold. So if you want to get into our advanced build, now's the time to do it.
Get ready.
Get ready. Brian, I'm afraid we've gone way over time for this episode.
I know, I was looking at the timer.
We kind of rushed to that last segment. Sorry about that. Now, folks, this was a lot of information. Everything from your questions to the information about photography, videography.
Our answers,
to the build. So, of course, you need to go to our show notes page.
Yes, and those live at twit.tv/KH. And you can also subscribe to, I guess you could do the audio version, if you're on your commute or something.
Yeah.
But we have subscribe links for video versions, HD, SD, and all our past episodes. So like you said, Padre, if you're going to start this project, you're going to want to go to the show page, check the show notes, and then follow the episodes that we have.
Yep.
So
there you go. Also, don't forget that we've got a Google Plus group. Just go to Google Plus and look for Know How. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and subscribe, and you can submit your projects. We love hearing from you. We love hearing your questions, and we love to see what you've done with the projects that we've given to you. So if you're a novice, if you're an expert, jump in, be part of the community. It's over 8,500 members strong.
Yes, yes, yes. Please post your pictures and show us how you've outdone us on your projects.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, G Plus isn't the only place to find us.
You can also find us on Twitter. I'm at @cranky_hippo.
And I'm at PadreSJ. That's twitter.com/PadreSJ. And our TD,
Mr. Gumpel.
Alex Gumpel, can be found. Hold on.
Oh, wait. Zoom in. Enhance.
Where is he? Where? He's hiding. Wait. I put on the focus.
Focus.
Okay. Focus. There he
is. That guy.
That guy can be found at ANEL3. That's ANEL3. Make sure you follow him and tell him how much you love the fact that he likes cutting our shows short.
That's right.
Although we went really long.
Today. I mean, what's another 10 minutes to this show?
I don't know. Next week, we're going to be introing you to the FPV hardware. We want to show you what's going to be going into this because you're going to have to buy that too if you're interested. Mm-hmm. And I believe we're also doing a few things with networking. If you want to prove that your ISP is giving you bad service, I'm going to give you a way to do it.
That's right.
Until then, I'm Father Robert Ballas here.
I'm Brian Burnett.
And now that you know how, go.